Hi, I'm Senator Kemp Hannon. Thanks for joining with us. We want to focus on part of the health care that's eating disorders, often affecting kids, often affecting teenage women. We have the best coming to talk to us today. Evlyn Attia is a physician and who has been heading the Center for Comprehensive Eating Disorders, but has helped the state create the center. We're not the experts. When people came with needs, we wanted to say what can be done. It's not necessarily all physically located in one place. It's taking experts working together in a problem. And, you know, it started because there was one peculiar thing in our system of health care and mental health care. We had mental health component, physical component, and we were not melding the two, and it was hurting individuals. And you've been running this a little bit. You've been helping direct it. There's a lot of peers that you have. You come with a great deal of knowledge, expertise. The national government gives you some research money every year. In itself, a great thing, because it's not easy to get. But, doctor, just tell us a little bit about where we're going since you've gotten the center up and running.
Absolutely, and thank you for having me today, Senator. It's important that we dedicate some time to really think about these disorders because, as you say, they are unusual. They are major mental illnesses, they are potentially life-threatening conditions, and they have as much chance of causing psychiatric emergency as medical emergency, and we don't have a lot of conditions quite like that. So we're really talking about anorexia nervosa, we're talking about bulimia nervosa and binge eating disorder. And when we put all those numbers together, even though each one of them may not be among the most common illnesses we have, we're talking about 500,000 to 1 million New Yorkers who are expected to have an eating disorder in their lifetime. So this isn't a small problem.
No. No, and leads to bigger problems unless you appropriately address it.
Absolutely. It's one of the illnesses where the most common story may begin in adolescence or early adulthood, but these are illnesses where if we catch them early and start with interventions at that point, we have a terrific chance of taking care of these in a relatively straightforward fashion. But for some, they really become chronic and they become complicated. And then we're talking about costly and serious treatments that are necessary throughout much of adulthood and much of a lifetime. The Comprehensive Care Center for Eating Disorders, which you mentioned,
yes,
really was a visionary decision on the part of New York State.
Well, let me just give a credit in there.
Okay.
Senator Bruno was leading the Senate. Mm-hmm. He had a problem. It was a niece or a granddaughter, mm-hmm. and he kept saying, well, why can't we resolve this? Mm-hmm. And it turned out the disorder was not eating, or it was overeating, I forget which, and that would lead to physical problems. Mm-hmm. The young lady would be treated in the physical health care system, mm-hmm. restored to health, and then discharged, and there was nobody looking after her in the mental health system. So what would happen? She'd wind up back in the hospital again. Mm-hmm. And it turned out, the more he asked, the less questions, less answers there were, and the more people that were affected. So it was his decision to kind of push this forward, and once he identified the problem, we all realized we had not been doing a good job.
No, absolutely. And as I say, it was really visionary to be thinking about this way, because these are disorders where we can't have one hand not knowing what the other hand is doing because they are so complicated. And I also say visionary because there it was 6 or 7 years ago that this was really getting this kind of attention and that the decisions were being made and laws were being passed. And really the system of care that these centers created are the very same kinds of system of care that we're now hearing from our governor we need present across the board. We need for any illness where if we're not representing coordinated care, if we have a system that might have duplicate services, well, that's not really going to be as helpful and as cost efficient as what's necessary going forward. In these systems, we've got networks of facilities. No one place has all parts, but we need to collaborate and cooperate in geographically diverse parts of the state to be able to represent all the necessary needs.
That was where, you know, mm-hmm. trading kudos here, but that was where you and the system put the system together. Mm-hmm. I mean, we didn't erect a building in any one mm-hmm. place. It was, can you work together? And I believe we have four centers in the state. of people in different geographic locations mm-hmm. coordinating care.
Mm-hmm. This has really been a partnership, a government clinician, government expert partnership. There are three separate centers. There's one in the metropolitan region that I direct, there's one in the Albany region, and there's one in the western part of the state. And across these centers, we have one specialized psychiatric inpatient program for eating disorders, and that's at New York Presbyterian Hospital. We have one major research center, and that's at the New York State Psychiatric Institute. We partner with a program that's really dedicated to children with these disorders, and that's at the Cohen's Children's Hospital. It's part of the LIJ system. There's one child residential, non-hospital, but residential program up in Rochester. And we're talking across state, right, on a regular basis so that people don't get lost, so that we're really able to better coordinate care and folks can use one part of the treatment here and be, you know, transferred smoothly to another part somewhere else in the system. This is a system that I think a lot of other areas of expertise can learn a lot from.
Oh, absolutely. And maybe it came along just at the right time that our communication system, the computers, mm-hmm. and you can Skype. It doesn't even cost you for the teleconferencing. Mm-hmm. But you can do all that together. Mm-hmm. But the other part of it is you had a dedication that was a shared vision, which is put mental health and physical health together.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And how well is that meshed?
Well, I think that, you know, we always could use more time, more money, more people, and all sorts of things that can really help us get all our answers. You had spoken about the partnership with the federal government, and absolutely support from the National Institute of Health is tremendously important as we find our questions that we don't have answers to yet and really pursue research ideas to try to get more answers. So how is it working? It's a work in progress. And the real concern, of course, is that we don't drop the ball, that we don't say, okay, been there, done that, or already dedicated some time and energy, but that we continue to try to improve our services and keep the support going.
Now, let me go back to some of the basics, mm-hmm. just so people, what are the symptoms we're dealing with here? Anorexia, bulimia, what are the types of things that are going
Absolutely.
On with
so young these are very
life?
Serious, very serious conditions. In anorexia nervosa, we're really talking about a problem of significant underweight with difficulties taking in enough to maintain normal weight or gain to normal weight, and some real problems with cognitions and ideas and beliefs that get in the way of believing that it's important to get to normal weight. So this isn't just a diet gone awry. This isn't just losing a little bit of weight. This is really semi-starvation, significant malnutrition in the context of a psychiatric problem that's near delusional at moments. Somebody really believes that it would be terrible for them, that it would be tremendously anxiety-provoking and worse if they were to come anywhere close to normal weight. So we're dealing with a psychiatric problem. We're dealing with a significant medical problem, and this condition comes with the highest rate of mortality, rate of death, that we see in any psychiatric illness.
Wow.
Okay, so it's really concerning. For bulimia nervosa, we're talking about a pattern that's usually not associated with low weight. It's associated with normal or sometimes even a little bit above normal weight, where there is a pattern of regular binge eating, eating an amount that's dramatically more than what's normal for a given period of time in a way that feels without any sense of self-control. And it is followed by vomiting behavior, purging of a number of different types of behaviors that are trying to compensate for that overeating. So these behaviors, if not treated correctly, come with electrolyte abnormalities, medical problems of a whole variety, and lots of changes to normal functioning.
Does the bulimia still have a sense that there's a goal, a mental goal to achieve?
Absolutely, there needs to be distortions about body shape and weight to have bulimia nervosa as well. So these are illnesses that, in general, come with changed ideas and thoughts and feelings about body shape and weight together with a behavioral disturbance, right, that gets someone into tremendous trouble.
And then, of course, if this continues as a pattern, their whole systems get weakened and susceptible to any number of different
Absolutely.
Disorders.
And in anorexia nervosa, probably every organ system can be affected if the illness isn't interrupted. The good news is we do have treatments, okay? For bulimia nervosa, right, in general, these are behavioral disturbances, right? Something is very, very wrong with eating behavior. So most of the treatments do hone in on behavioral change and behavioral improvement. For bulimia nervosa, we know that cognitive behavioral therapy, a focused psychotherapy that really looks at the cycle of thoughts and behaviors that get set up and tries to interrupt them in very, very specific ways, we know that's very, very helpful for bulimia nervosa.
Is that interruption a counseling type of thing, a discussion type of thing? Does it have drugs involved?
Well, that's a talking therapy. We also know that a number of the antidepressants are very, very helpful for changing the urge to binge eat and purge that come with bulimia nervosa. We have for our youngest patients with anorexia nervosa, there's a family-based therapy that actually helps families take a very central role in helping their loved ones change behavior, and that can be very, very useful. Things get a little bit more complicated if illnesses have been present for a while and someone moves into adulthood with these illnesses, or they've failed attempts at other treatments, or they've never sought treatment and they've had the illness for a long period of time. And then we start to try to help people change behaviors using higher levels of care, day treatment programs, residential programs, hospital-based programs. We still have the same goals, helping people with these significant behavioral disturbances change behavior so that they're in a better position to go on and understand other underlying problems that may have made them vulnerable to some of this. But we really need to get that behavioral change to happen. We need someone who's severely underweight to get to normal weight. We need people with bulimia nervosa to interrupt the cycle and stop these dangerous behaviors.
How do you get one of these folks who are patients to actually cooperate with you? Because this all of a sudden they have to be denying a belief they used to have, and that's a big change.
This is a challenge, and in the work that we do in psychiatry generally, we're up against often thoughts and ideas that someone might have. Usually there's a place with some motivation. Maybe someone doesn't want to gain 20 pounds, but maybe they're aware that school hasn't gone as well, that the classes that they wanted to participate in, even some of the sports they may have wanted to participate in, coaches are saying, wait a minute. Others, families are saying, you know, you really can't continue to do activities such and such. We need, as mental health professionals, to really try to find the place where somebody is motivated to make a difference and to make a change. Sometimes that doesn't happen right at the beginning, and families should really hear from me that they shouldn't give up, that we may need to get treatment started when someone really isn't quite sure that this is something they want to do. But motivation changes and willingness changes as someone starts to get healthier and realize that it might be less scary than they had anticipated and that there's really tremendous benefit to achieving recovery.
That's what I meant when they have to give up a belief that they have, getting them over that hurdle. It's the pride of authorship of, no, this is me. I don't want to leave this.
Well, there's an element of this is me, and there's an element almost like in obsessive compulsive disorder. Someone has the idea. They don't think it's just a random idea. They really believe it at that moment that they have to do certain kinds of behavior. So we have to be able to challenge that and help partner with them so that they think it's worth giving a try to another way.
Suppose a family has a problem. What should they do?
Well, they should certainly get an evaluation. And often the first person to go to might be their pediatrician or their internist or somebody that the individual knows or that they have in their community. And we're really trying to get the word out to those. These centers that we're talking about also have a mission to educate and get the word out and make sure people know about early identification and prevention. But hopefully a hometown clinician is able to get some of the basic evaluation conducted, and if a specialist evaluation is needed, there are these centers across the state, and it's important to know that they exist and to reach out to us, and we're happy to make those evaluations and get treatment
in place. You were there 7 years ago. I mean, I think the closest place was maybe Connecticut. There was also a place in Arizona or New Mexico.
A lot of places out of state, and they were doing our work for us in certain ways, and it's been terrific to be able to let people know that we've got treatment close to home.
Are you encountering any problems in the coordination of paying for this from the insurance companies? Now that we do have a mental health parity provision and statute?
You know, there's no question that it is hard for folks to use available resources to get this kind of care the care moves beyond those more straightforward outpatient approaches.
I just wanted to raise it because we have 10 seconds left, but I just let people know that it's not something new that we are trying to resolve.
Absolutely. We're trying to get help. You've been tremendously helpful at trying to get the word out.
Dr. Attia, thank you very much for being with us. Appreciate it. I thank you very much for tuning in. I'm Senator Kemp Hannon. I'll see you again next time.